Last year, I started losing a lot of weight, and I didn't know why. The doctors ran a CAT scan, and it showed that I have a growth in my pancreas area. I was really, really scared, and my grace group, they surrounded me, they prayed for me, and it just brought me a lot of peace. I was really, really scared that I might be seriously ill. About 4 months ago, I went in for another test, and it was so wonderful to hear the news that nothing, they couldn't find anything on that test, nothing that was on the CAT scan could be seen. The doctors were amazed. They can't figure out how I was healed. God broke through. He brought healing into my life. It was a miracle. It was all Him.
Because of me being hurt from past relationship and knowing that I was treated very bad, I knew that God was always by my side. He was there. He was my... Just knowing that someone like promised that He was gonna be there, like God never did leave me, never forsaken me. So I held on to that hope and like that I never did give up because he was my peace in all things. So I'm thankful for His mercy. That's why I have that compassion, heart of compassion towards people.
In 2011, my brother committed suicide. I was very depressed, so I resorted to alcohol and partying. I even went suicidal. I tried to kill myself so many times in so many ways, but it didn't work. And it was not until last year that God's love broke through. I joined the Grace group, and I was finally saved. And I also got baptized. And this past conference, God showed His real love to me, and I finally rededicated myself to Him.
The arrow that was was headed to my heart. But you hit the mark. When love.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
Every service I've done that, it never gets old. Jesus redeemed. He redeemed us personally and secured our eternity by bearing all of our sin, in fact, and becoming sin. And by doing so, he paid the full penalty required of us to secure eternity in heaven. Scripture says, for our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Scripture also says that God shows his love for us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Here's the point. God loves us just as we are. We cannot earn his approval. When Jesus said on the cross, it is finished, the point at which it was finished at that moment was when he literally became sin. You know why he said, Father, why have you forsaken me? It is at that point, that apex is when he took upon himself all the sin of the world that our Heavenly Father could not look on his Son at all. Because though God loves the sinner, he hates sin. It's as if you who are parents or grandparents, you have the Ebola virus slopped onto your child in every pore of his body, and that wouldn't even come close. God's Son became so contagious for that for the only time ever the Father and the Son were separated, and God the Father had to look away from his only begotten Son. He became sin at that point, which is why Jesus felt abandoned. But because he loved us, he came. because he loved the Father, he came. There's not a more powerful force in the universe than love. That's the gospel. But crucifixion was only one part of it. Jesus would not stay in the tomb, and Easter is about his resurrection. And it's his crucifixion and resurrection put together that declares our victory over sin, secures our eternity, and allows us, opens the door for us to be reconciled to God. Because here's what God's after today. He's after a relationship, a personal, intimate relationship. Let's take a look here. On the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early and saw that the stone had been taken away from the tomb. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb and stooped to look into the tomb, turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" And supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus, watch this now, Jesus said to her, "Mary." And she turned and said to him in Aramaic, which is the pidgin English of that day, he says, "Rabboni," or teacher, Messiah. Only when Jesus said her name personally did she recognize our Savior, and he had come for her. A lot of people this time of year know about God. We know about God, we know about the Bible, we know about the crucifixion, we know about the resurrection. People wear crosses around their necks not knowing anything what that means. But knowing about God and knowing God are two different things. They're both important. And you can know about the resurrection, and you can know facts about the Bible, but here's what the heart of Jesus craves this morning. He craves a personal, devoted relationship with you. He paid a tremendously, tremendously dear price for that. Let's take a look at the screen and see how that might have played out. Watch this.
Why are you crying?
Have you taken him?
Who?
If you've taken him, please tell me where, and I will get him.
Mary.
Isn't it interesting that the first person Jesus shows himself to after his resurrection was a woman? Don't read into that statement. All the women say it. This is weaker than all the other previous services. That's so weak. You know, a parody at Amen. It wasn't a man, it was a woman. And you know what the thing about this woman? She was possessed of 7 demons, which means she was not a godly woman. She was not a clean woman. In fact, the only way you have demonic infestation in a person's life is if they've been terribly ensconced in a life of sin, in its most sordid. She was probably from a cursed family. Some tradition says she was the prostitute many times over, and yet wealthy. No one really knows, except Jesus chose a woman who was considered unclean. Jesus said, "You're the one I want to show myself to first." And what's the message in that? It doesn't matter the kind of life we've lived. It doesn't matter the kind of person we've been or think we've been. It's not about where we've been or what we've done. It's about who He is. It's not about the life we've lived. It's about a life He gave. The question is, will we receive Him? It's not about how clean we are. None of us can measure up to God's standard. That's why Jesus came. He lived the life we should have lived, fulfilling all righteousness for us. We don't have to worry about that. He died the death we should have died, paying this penalty for sin. He shed the blood that we should have shed that purchases our redemption. That's so cool. And all He does is He extends His hand to you this morning and He says, will you receive me into your heart? Will you turn from sin and turn to me? And will you surrender your life for me? And let's begin the greatest journey. Let's begin the greatest journey of all to your destiny as to why you're on the planet. That's what Easter is. Easter's not about rubbing the bunny, coloring the egg, folks. I'm sorry. Yeah, raised three girls, I get all that. We did all that. Rub the bunny, color the egg, but main thing is Jesus. Say His name, Jesus. That's what Mary said. But more importantly, Jesus says your name and He's after a connection. So how do we connect to Jesus? Well, we connect to Jesus by receiving Him personally by faith and following Him intimately by grace. Grace meaning His overcoming power. Because once we receive Him, we need to follow Him. And the only way that's possible is by His presence and power. I've done it for over 40 years. I come from Kalihi. I spoke Aramaic. Graduated from Farrington High School. I can read and write. I don't have any great pedigree. Over 40 years later, I'm a pastor. And I got people in this church. We have our 45th reunion high school. They can't believe I'm a pastor. They still can't believe it. We've been to about 7 reunions. I said, when you gonna believe I'm a pastor? I said, well, you of all people, see, that's the grace of God. He gives us the grace to live a life that God wants you to live. And sometimes we live the life we think we want to live, but that's not the life He wants us to live. He wants us to live the life He wants us to live, which is why He put you on the planet. Slap your neighbor and say, what the heck is he saying? Well, I got a guy here who's going to say it better, but very shortly, let's look at this. He was in the world was made through Him, yet the world did not know Him. He came to His own, and His own people did not receive Him, but to all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right, that word means power and authority, to become children of God. This is a connection. This is a personal, intimate, family relationship, and love only breaks through at the point religion becomes relationship. Knowing about God turns into knowing God. And so rather than this old guy, we're going to get a younger guy up here. He's a graduate of Pearlside High School because he couldn't pass the entrance exam to Farrington. This is Andrew Sato. Come on up. You did put on the lay.
Yeah.
Okay, there are tall Japanese people on the planet. Andrew is the perfect Easter story in that he grew up knowing about God, facts about Jesus and the Bible, but he didn't know God. Part of the reason is he's very gifted. He's very good looking, as you can see, and tall. And sometimes when you are the package, so to speak, you don't need God. When you grew up, you believed in God. Did you believe in God?
I did. I growing up, I was always told that you go to church on Sundays, you sit in church, you read the Bible, you pray, you do good things, and that's what you do. And that's what I did.
Christian home. Mm-hmm. And yet, the Lord wasn't really living in here yet. Self-made man, that's what you told me. Gifted. Ran a nightclub. Let's take a look at a nightclub shot here. Okay, there you go. All right, it's NBA playoff time. Is he in the playoffs now?
No,
New York. New York sucks.
Injured. Yeah. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
This is Derrick Rose, and so you made a lot of friends with people like that. It seems like people are magnetized to you. They love you. They like you. You have a charm about you. Life's good. Life was good then, and then you joined the Yakuza because life's really good. Let's show his. That ain't the Yakuza, okay? But okay. Come on, guys. Okay. You're the one in the middle. a terrible life of crime. Actually, to clarify this, he's part of the Yakuza team that acts on Hawaii Five-0. How many of you heard of that show before? Okay, and I watched the show where they shot you in the head. And so they reprise the Yakuza, they give you $3,000 for saying one word and a personal trailer. Life's good. Life's good. Even if you do get shot in the head, they'll bring you back to life because we'll forget about who you were in that past movie. So you've got the arts going with you. You've got starring commercials. You do all these other things. Life's good. You're in control. God's in the trunk. Bring them out on Easter. Bring them out on Christmas and put them back in the trunk. But that's not really knowing him. So what happens is you pretty much have an awakening. On top of everything else, you have computer skills, good with technology. You have your own media marketing firm, so good that you thought you could go undetected by the law. What happened?
Well, I was always tech savvy, good with computers, could always figure things out. And I figured out how to do a little bit of hacking, and I ended up committing.
A little bit of hacking.
Yeah, so I ended up committing wire fraud. So for my own benefit, and I got away with it for a while, and I ended up getting busted. I got arrested and ended up getting sentenced for 18 months.
So all of a sudden, what was so good turned so bad, and you're in prison.
Yeah, so I'm in prison, spent about a little over a year in federal prison.
Federal prison?
Yeah, in federal prison.
Okay. And you know, we've had guys up here that dealt drugs, used drugs, maybe abused people, maybe killed people over the years we've been at church. We've had all kind of interviews. You're the first computer hacker we've ever had. Up to date.
Yeah, so...
Turning point.
It was. It was a huge turning point in my life. It was probably, I still look at it as probably one of the best things that's ever happened to me. Again, I was always going to church. I grew up in a, being told what I'm supposed to do. But it wasn't until I actually hit the lowest point of my life, being in prison, just really making my own choice to actually have a relationship with God. You know, at all the time in the world, because everything was taken from me, my friends and family far away from me. And I actually went to the library and said, I'm just gonna make the most and just read as much as I can, found the Bible, and I've always read the Bible, always read scriptures in church, sat in church and saw the scriptures on the screen or wherever and just read it, but actually decided, I'm gonna read the Bible from cover to cover. And it's amazing because a lot of those verses that you read growing up, it's different because God's actually speaking to you, and those words just mean so much more when you're actually developing a relationship with God.
That's where you really found the Lord and the Lord found you. There was a connection in the tomb called prison.
Yep.
So the Lord came from the trunk into the front seat now of your life's vehicle. So the Word of God begins to change you, and then you begin to change the prison. Tell us about that.
So before, it was always just all about me. I was worried about me. Worried about what God was going to do for me, how God was going to help me, but it let me grow. I grew in prison. My relationship with God developed, and I started looking and started noticing needs around me and how I could help people around me. And then so I actually saw that there was church, there was no music, so I played the piano, sang for church, and helped out with that. I noticed that a lot of these inmates were high school dropouts, didn't have their high school diploma, so I created a tutoring session where I could actually help the inmates get their GEDs and, get something.
That's pretty remarkable. You talked about singing in church. Obviously, part of the trail, one of the setbacks of being so gifted is you don't need God, so you put him in the trunk. You won Hawaii Idol, we've got a picture, and then you went to the quarterfinals of American Idol. Maybe let's see that here on screen. We can put that up. There you are. Okay. There's less of you, more of God, but physically there's less of you as well. Because this is a picture before what we call the prison weight loss program. There's a lot more of you there physically. There's a lot less of you now physically, but a lot less of you, but more of Jesus.
Yeah, right? So I got to lose some weight too. I lost a little bit, about 80 pounds.
80
so
pounds.
If you ever want to lose weight, just commit a crime. You don't have, no, you don't do that, don't.
Yeah, he was joking. Okay, so, but I look at it this way, Andrew. I think you determined so much to follow Jesus there and turn your life around. I look at losing 80 pounds. That 80 pounds represents that life of sin you left behind, that burden. You get released, and it's like, this is it. Jesus is moving in victory and triumph. Everything should be good. You meet a beautiful woman, Ashley, who's here this morning somewhere, okay? And my God. But then you buy a home. This thing is supposed to play out very well. But something goes drastically wrong with the home, the American dream. What happened?
Yeah, so, you know, after that, we still dealt with a lot of lows. In October 2015, my family and I were displaced from our home. My wife and my 3-year-old son. We basically had some structural damage from these trees that grew outside our unit, and it caused water intrusion, which caused mold, which it wasn't, you know, safe for my family and I to live in. So we had to move out. I had to pay to live outside, at the same time pay a mortgage for a place that my family and I couldn't live in. It was frustrating because the association, those who were responsible, weren't taking responsibility. And in the meantime, just trying to find a place for my family
to live. You're very tempted to take things into your own hand and take vengeance because you know how to do that. You're living in one room, essentially.
Yeah, we've been living in a room. And then, you know, I ended up hiring a lawyer. Lawyer ends up dragging their feet too, so I'm pretty frustrated.
What were you thinking? What was your dialogue with God like during that time?
You know, it was like, again, I started feeling helpless, like how I was in prison. Like I had no control over everything that was happening. And I just prayed and I just said, God, you have a plan. You have a bigger plan for everything. There's a reason all this is happening.
Right. So take a break. Take the family to Genki.
Yes. So I was a big scallop fan. And so I ended up eating the scallops and I got sick, ended up in the ER twice and was sick for over 3 months.
You had hepatitis.
Yeah.
Arguably, he was the first one and he had hepatitis like really bad. He felt like he was gonna die. You told me it was like 3 months of intense fever, nausea, and like you were gonna die. And you really thought you might.
Yeah, it was even more frustrating. So again, we're out of a home. And I just felt helpless. And, you know, I have a family to take care of, and I'm trying to put them in a home. And so we put in an offer for a house. I'm trying to stress and trying to force it to happen. So, And at the time, my wife was at the end of her pregnancy for our second baby. And so I'm stressed and trying to put us in a home. And then I got hit with Hep A and I ended up being sick. You know, there's nothing you could take to recover or speed up the recovery process. So I'm sick, just lying in bed, just feeling completely helpless. And
Andrew, here's the question, you know, because this is where most of us live. We don't live a movie script. What was your dialogue with the Lord during this time?
You know, as tough as it was, I still knew God had a plan for everything. You know, like you said before, God is always doing more than we know, more than we can see. And it was tough, but because of my relationship with the Lord, because of what I dealt with, the lowest points, I was able to get through it. And, you know, going back to prison, you know, when I got arrested, I woke up and I knew I was doing wrong. And I prayed, I joined the worship team and I said, God, okay, I'm sorry. You know, I prayed and I said, God, you're going to take care of me. I'm not going to go to prison. I'm good.
This is just before you went into prison. You
before
had to do the
prison.
Church thing, score points with God.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
Use religion to get you to beat the rap.
So I prayed and I said, okay, God's going to take care of me, help me. And then I ended up getting sentenced and I was like, God, what's going on? I thought you were going to answer my prayers. And then it actually got worse. I mean, then my ex-girlfriend at the time I was dating, she left me. And then to make matters worse, she ended up dating the youth group pastor of my church at the time. So, like, even more so.
The church that you were going to, but that you didn't know the Lord. Yeah. You were just trying to use religion to get a favor from the Lord. That didn't work. God put you in the tomb. You come out of the tomb now. You go, what the heck? I'm out of a house. I'm out of my health. Not to mention, listen to this. When he was young, he had a brain tumor, and he still has half the tumor in his brain. They couldn't remove it all, or else he'd die. So, what are the impact? What was the results of that tumor that you still have in your head?
So, when I was in sixth grade, I had a brain tumor. I used to get these migraines and couldn't function, and I ended up having to get surgery. Only half of it was removed because they were afraid I was going to lose my hearing, and half my face or my body would be paralyzed. I ended up losing my hearing anyway, so I'm completely deaf in my left ear.
Not bad. You go to American Idol, deaf, half deaf.
Yeah. All right.
I got guys. We know guys who can hear totally and they can't sing. Okay, so this is a real good deal. That was unnecessary. I'm sorry. That's a good line. Not to mention back surgery.
Yeah, so I had a lot of health complications. Tumor,
not to
back
mention
surgery.
The fact that you came from a badly broken home.
Yeah, so, yeah, I grew up not knowing
have
my
you,
father.
Did you ever shake your fist in God and go, what the heck, God? It ain't Happy Easter. Did you ever go through that?
I did. I even did when I got sentenced. I went to prison. But like I said, God has a plan for everything. You know, God could have just said, okay, you're not going to go to prison, you get probation, slap on the wrist, you're good. But then I wouldn't have gone through everything I would have gone through. I wouldn't have learned that it was not just all about me, that God had a bigger plan for not just me, but for everybody around me, my friends, my family, the people who I touched, the people who I meet, all the inmates that I talked to, all the inmates that I worked with and helped. And I knew that even going through Hep A, being displaced from our home, and the home that we put an offer for fell through, so it was even more frustrating. And then, because I actually stopped working, so we couldn't get home.
There is a resurrection, though. It was, I mean, Andrew, it's a very, very long journey. Here's the powerful thing. In the resurrection phase, obviously, let's take a look at your wife and you in front of the home. She's a babe. I gotta say, you married up, okay? But then there's the children. Check these kids out. Man, that's not Yakuza kids, yeah? Those are Easter Bunny ears?
Yeah.
Okay, just checking. Your business, the point at which you were in prison was because of your skills with, shall we say, media and technology. You've had a business with clients that was successful. And then a larger company comes and wants you and lets you keep your business with its clients. And now you work for this other large firm, and it's like God, at the point of where you committed your crime, blesses that and gives you a double portion financially.
Yeah, so again, God has a plan for everything. And, you know, because I got sick, I stopped working at my other company, and I ended up going back to Summit Media Radio Group. But this time they offered me a position as a local sales manager with a much higher salary, and which also allowed us to be able to afford a brand new home, which we put an offer for, and we're finally going to be able to move into a home. We're going to get the keys this Friday.
Yeah. So. That's awesome. And this home is much better than the last one.
Yeah, it's a nice brand new home. And, you know, God took care of everything. We were able to fix up the old place, sell it, and use it as a down payment for the new home.
God worked. He works everything out. He works everything out. A parting shot to all of us from this journey, from being buried in the tomb to resurrection. Because you kept a confession of faith through times when many people run from the Lord and shake their fist at him. Leave us with something today, Andrew, this Easter.
You know, no matter what you've been through, what you've done, no matter what you're going through. You know, like I said, I really believe God has a plan for everything, a big, big plan for everything. And you may not see it, but God's doing more than you can see. And, you know, if you have that relationship with God, God's just doing more in your life, and not just for you, but again, for everybody around you.
It's easy when you're in the resurrection phase, but when you're in the tomb and God's still doing something deep in your soul, that's when you keep the faith. I know the tears keep coming in every service. You're a little emotional. You think you can pump out a sample, the first verse of Amazing Grace as we close?
Sure.
Okay. Understand the emotion. Want you to join in the moment as we honor God. Just close your eyes and think about Jesus and the Lord and where you are and where He is and who He is.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me.
Father, touch our hearts.
Thanks for joining us. Visit our website at pearlside.org for more.